Beijing is responding sternly to the landslide win by pro-democracy candidates in Hong Kong's district elections by emphasizing the city is still ruled by China.
No matter what happens in Hong Kong, it is part of the Chinese territory and a special administrative region of China. Any attempt to destabilize Hong Kong or even to damage its prosperity and stability will never succeed.
Hong Kong pro-democracy parties won 90% of the seats up for grabs, according to public broadcaster RTHK. Almost 3 million people voted. That is a record turnout. But the election results pose a dilemma now for Hong Kong's chief executive, Carrie Lam. She says the government will seriously reflect on the outcome of the election. But the big question in the days and weeks to come is whether the government will heed the calls for political reform.
At the same time, we are monitoring pro-democracy lawmakers who marched on Monday demanding humanitarian assistance for the protesters still holed up, if you remember, inside the Polytechnic University. Hong Kong police say a negotiating team is trying to peacefully persuade them to come out. The school, if you remember, was the site of a violent clash between police as well as pro-democracy protesters earlier this month.
Let's bring in Jamie Metzl in New York. He is a senior fellow with the Atlantic Council, an international affairs think tank. Jamie, thank you for being with us. I want to go over that Carrie Lam quote again. She says the government will listen humbly to the citizens' opinions and reflect on them seriously. Do you think these elections are somehow going to force a rethink, a reassessment, or even reforms from Carrie Lam's government?
Well, that's the big question is, will they think about what is the message? Obviously, they will. Do they want to reform? Maybe. Can they reform? Probably not. I mean, that's the whole point, is Hong Kong has had in the past at least a hope that there's going to be some kind of democratic process. And these protesters are fighting for a say in their futures. And right now, Beijing seems to be setting the tone. And the people of Hong Kong recognize that if they don't fight for democracy now, their future could look like Xinjiang does today. And this is really serious stuff. And the stakes are high. But I don't have a lot of faith that Carrie Lam can or even will deliver any meaningful reforms.
And Jamie, on that point, I mean, they may be listening, but if they're not prepared to actually make any changes, agree to any of their five demands, talk to us about what this can mean. Are we could be looking at more protests, you think, and more protests intensifying the streets?
Well, I think we're absolutely going to see more protests because the Hong Kong government can't deliver what the protesters want, which is what the people of Hong Kong were promised by Beijing. And the reason why Beijing isn't willing to allow any kind of meaningful democratic reform in Hong Kong is that Beijing is already massively suppressing the people of Xinjiang, the Tibetans, and if there is a whiff that the actual people can have power to determine their future, even in the most peaceful ways, that is seen by the government of China as a threat. And that's why this is so, so serious. And that's why the international community, the United States and others need to stand by the people of Hong Kong. And it's also why the protesters in Hong Kong need to make sure that these protests are peaceful.
The pro-democracy camp just won these local council elections in a landslide. There's no argument about that. How much formal power does that give them in Hong Kong's political system? Because last time I checked, these local councils concern themselves with traffic lights, congestions, issues, and bus stops and things like that.
Yeah. They have very little power. They have more influence than they previously had, and they have delivered a message. So this isn't right now about seizing control of the government because the people of Hong Kong don't have the ability to guide their own future because of what Beijing has done and denying the people of Hong Kong the democratic reforms that were promised by Beijing. And so the people of Hong Kong have to build the momentum, and they have to draw upon the goodwill that exists for them around the world, which is very different from the people of Xinjiang, who are completely isolated in Tibet, people isolated and disempowered. The people of Hong Kong have a tremendous amount of goodwill, and they need to be smart and strategic and nonviolent and build an international network of support, because this is going to be a long-term struggle. But as I said before, the stakes are incredibly high.
So, Nick, Carrie Lam playing down the landslide victory pulled off by pro-democracy candidates and talking about residents no longer tolerating demonstrations. Where's she going with this?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of a split-screen moment, really, isn't it, after the extraordinary results that we saw in the last 48 hours. Frankly, unprecedented, breaking records here in Hong Kong. The most number of voters they've seen in the highest turnout of 71%. As you said then, about 87% of the seats now going for pro-democracy movements. I should point out, though, possibly Carrie Lam is referring to the fact that the number of people who cast votes was not pro-democracy as high in the percentage of the high 80s. There were sort of slightly less, but because of the first-past-the-post system, it resulted in this landslide number of local council seats. Local council seats, I should point out, not seats that in fact impact what happens behind me in the Legislative Council, the real levers of power here in Hong Kong. But it was extraordinary that this remarkable mandate, frankly, that seems to have been given to the protesters here, even some of the councillors standing in the pro-democracy movement explicitly involved in the protests themselves that turned violent. It was extraordinary that Ms. Lam decided to choose that mandate, given overwhelming as it was, to suggest that perhaps people were in fact tired of the violence. In fact, it showed the opposite, that really no matter what disruption has happened here in Hong Kong, damage to the economy that's now in recession, daily life often uprooted on an hourly basis, that people still chose democracy over the stability that she's often been touting here, Rosemary.
What about China? What's been the latest reaction from there to the results of these local elections?
I think we can possibly interpret from some of the silence a degree of surprise. I don't think, frankly, even pro-democracy campaigners expected results of this nature. There had perhaps been concerns in their camp that maybe people had got tired of the disruption of the protest. But China on the day itself said that Hong Kong would remain part of China, quote, no matter what. I don't think anybody really doubts that's the case. And then we've also heard today suggestions that they would like to see the United States and other countries keep their hands out of China's internal affairs. That's references to some of the incidents that have occurred in the lead up to this election, some of the comments made by US officials, and also the Hong Kong bill yet to be signed by President Trump, which could potentially censure some figures here in Hong Kong for disrupting the pro-democracy movement. So, China, I think, possibly taken aback by how this plays out, but also, too, maybe not necessarily having to do very much immediately. They still have a tough line against the protests here. They still 100% control what happens here inside of Hong Kong and still have not found their grip on the council behind me or Ms. Lam's grip on power changed by these local council votes. They control bus routes. They control trash collection. It's an extraordinary sign that the people of Hong Kong want to see more democracy, want those five demands met. You couldn't get a clearer signal, but it hasn't resulted in a different Hong Kong since that particular election result came out. Rosemary?